Hi, welcome back to Bedford Common. This is a very special edition
we have, right? It is our summer edition.
And it's been a real hot summer, too.
It's been a hot summer.
But we had to introduce ourselves. I forgot who I was.
Oh, I'm Julie Turner.
Oh, I'm Ralph Hammond.
Yes, that's right. Hey, Julie. This is absolutely fantastic. You've brought guests.
Well, I didn't bring them. They came themselves, but they came the long way.
Okay, and through Rotary.
Well, it was through Rotary, but our guests actually live just down the street from my house, so they just could have come over, but they didn't.
They didn't? How did they get here?
Well, one went by way of Belgium. And the other one went by way of Bolivia. So they came here the longest way you could.
They are the longest.
So who are our guests?
I was just going to ask you the same thing.
Our guests is Noor and Kara. Did I get it right?
Kara.
Noor and Kara Mentz.
Whoa.
Yes, I got it right.
Yeah.
I'm always mispronouncing names, and I apologize for that.
So how did you make such a long trip to Bedford, Noah and Kara?
Well, so we're twins, and we moved here for our senior year, and then we were only in Bedford a year, and then we took a gap year with Rotary. So in total, we've kind of been like in Bedford, as in like our home is here in Bedford for 2 years, but we were only here for one.
Whoa, and so your gap year was as Rotary exchange students?
Yes.
Yes.
Well, aren't you really the smartest person to find these people for us to come and talk to?
They were the one. Well, no, I just knew them because they lived down the street, bringing the neighborhood. But anyway, okay. So Karen Noah had the really courage to decide to go off instead of going directly to college, but to go off and take a gap year and do something very special. So tell about. Kara, tell about some of the stuff you did and where you went and maybe
and how
even
you made the decision.
And maybe even why you went, yes.
Yeah, so I knew that I wanted to study international relations in school, and I really wanted to be fluent in a second language. So I decided to take a gap year and go on exchange really for the like language immersion to learn Spanish. And I had taken Spanish just in school, but nothing else than that. And then I just kind of was like, well, I mean, you only have one opportunity to do this, so I may as well go. Wow. And so I signed up and I was off. And I went to Bolivia, as in Santa Cruz, Bolivia, which is the biggest city there. And I honestly, when I made the decision to go, my decision was between Bolivia and Paraguay. I knew nothing. I knew that they spoke Spanish, they didn't have an ocean, and they were in the mountains, I think. Oh, they have two capitals, which in reality they don't. But
wow. And you also, Noah, went to Bolivia?
No, I went over to Belgium, actually. So in school, in seventh grade, we were given the option for our language, and I chose to go with French. So I studied French for 6 years and decided to keep doing that with my exchange and practice French in Belgium. And it was awesome. They told me I was in this small town called Braine-l'Alleud. What they didn't tell me was that is right next to Waterloo, as in the Battle of Waterloo.
Whoa.
So everything in Belgium was just, it was super historic. There was history everywhere, and it was a great experience.
This is pretty cool.
Can I go back and be in high school again and do something? They might not choose me. Well, let's just go with what we've got. So those sound like fabulous years.
They definitely were.
Yeah, it was a lot.
Well, yes, it was. Did you make the decision simultaneously? It just seemed right for both of you?
Our mom actually had gone on exchange after her senior year to Mexico.
Ah.
So it was always kind of in the back of our minds that this was a possibility to go with Rotary on an exchange. And it just seemed right for me. So I chose, I was going to go. And I don't know for Kara, but I think it was the same. And then we started our application with Rotary here at the same time.
And our interview applied through the Bedford Rotary Club.
Yeah, we did.
And our interview was actually side by side. They just had it at the same time. Yeah.
So I don't know if you knew this, but when we did our interview, I thought they would just be like, oh, we'll get back to you. And then they're like, oh, congratulations, you're exchange students. I was like, oh, okay. And they're like, all right, we're doing the paperwork right now. And I was like, I had no idea it was the same day. I went from like interviewing to like picking countries that I was going to. So,
whoa.
I mean, I guess we did make the decision at the same time because I don't think either of us knew that it was going to be
so
that day.
who did the interview?
Melinda.
Was it Melinda?
And Robin Hopes from Acton.
That's
okay.
Right.
All right, great.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so part of the deal was we had to have inbound students too.
Yeah.
So who did you switch with?
So Daya and David from Japan and Argentina were like, they came in our spots.
Oh, they stayed in your house?
Yeah, they were
slept in your bed.
Yeah. So, but we only got to meet Daya, and like we barely overlapped with them at the very end. So
did you each stay with three families the way they do here in the United States?
No, I didn't.
I was able to. I had three families set up for me before I even left, and it was just really smooth, and I was able to really connect with each one of them.
So the way it started at the beginning, once you were chosen, then they chose a Rotary Club, or was the Rotary Club already determined at that point?
They chose a Rotary Club for me after I had decided to go to Belgium. The Belgium side handles that. So they'll decide which student goes to which clubs, and then the club will decide which families will host which students.
Ah, and so you had three, you only had one.
When I got there, my club had like one family for each person, and then I ended up changing just for like the experience and like to learn about other people's lives. So I ended up having two, but it's like every club there is different. Even in Santa Cruz, we had three clubs, and like they all did things differently. So
wow, because I thought we had to have at least two, because sometimes we can't always get three parents. So we always try to have two or three.
Well, you had two and you had three.
So you worked out well, and that's the idea, to learn different cultures. So do you find these families very different? Or
mine were super different. But, I liked both of them. We got along, and it was really cool to see just how different every family is, and I feel like I learned so much. Things that I thought were just, standard in Bolivia, maybe, because I was only with one family. I was like, oh, this other family doesn't do it like that, or it was really cool.
Were the same with you?
Yeah, for me, I had a whole variety of families. My second family actually didn't speak a word of English.
Yeah.
So that really helped in my language.
Same.
Full immersion, yes. So each family had their own little quirks. That it was just great. I loved all of them, and all the little quirky things that made them different were just great.
Did you find things to be the same?
No, not at all.
Yeah.
We had lived in the Netherlands before, so we were close to Belgium, and we kind of knew the European culture a little bit. So there's some things that are different in Europe that we had known about, and some things I found myself that were very different from the US, but a lot of things were pretty close.
What was the most different, Noah?
The most different, in my mind, was at restaurants you need to pay for bottled water, and it's always sparkling or flat in the bottles.
Yeah.
So if you're not careful in the vending machines and you just want a nice, refreshing bottle of water, it could be sparkling if you don't like that.
You could get it with gas, yeah.
Yep. And I do not care for sparkling water, so I always got tripped up in the vending machines.
Kara, did you have that problem?
Yeah, so just because we were in Bolivia, where I lived, you could drink the water. You didn't have to drink bottled water. But there were a lot of places that you couldn't, in the other cities. But we never had sparkling water. It was just sometimes when we would travel and stuff, we had to buy water or soda or something because it's not always safe to drink the water, which I don't know. It makes you appreciate the U.S. that you could literally drink out of your hose if you wanted to.
And this past weekend when it was so warm, I bet a lot of people did. So you're wearing quite the sack,
yes,
Kira.
So this is my Rotary blazer, and then the pins are all from different exchange students, and then I have my medal from the sport that we have down there that's called Sestoval. That was a competition that we won. And then my sash is actually, I participated in a beauty pageant.
More
my friend signed me up for a beauty pageant.
Your friends down there.
Yes.
Yes, okay.
And it was super last minute. I think I had 4 days to prepare. We didn't even know what was going to be in it. We didn't know if there was questions or
I was going to ask what the preparation might have involved.
Originally they told us there was going to be questions. There was going to be formal wear, sports wear, and a casual outfit. And then in the end, every day it changed. And then in the end, we had a Facebook poll, formal wear, casual outfit. I had to dance on the stage,
Are you
impromptu. No, I don't dance.
You do now.
And then they asked us maybe like one question, I think. Yeah. So I actually won. I brought
you
my
won?
Crown. All because right. I was like, where am I ever gonna like get to right wear on. This again?
Oh man.
So
oh, I don't think we've ever had anything quite so fancy yeah. and wonderful.
Did Noah get a two wrap?
I did not have the chance to participate in any impromptu beauty pageants in Belgium.
Well, but we were given to understand that you might have been very helpful in your sister's victory.
Ah, yes. So I actually heard about this beauty pageant when Kira sent me the link one day. She was like, oh, there's this little poll on Facebook. Help me out real quick. So I click on this link to Facebook, and it's this photo of her in this dress with like a sash across. And I was trying to using Google Translate and friends to figure out what it said in Spanish. And the comment was like, help Kira Mance win, like, Mrs. International Exchange, like student.
International Relations.
Yeah, International Relations Beauty Pageant. And I was like, oh, this is too good. So I actually sent it to, we had a Belgian exchange group chat on GroupMe that was maxed out at 256 people. So we sent it into multiple different group chats like that to get a couple hundred votes for Kira's win.
Yeah.
Wow. You deserved every one of them.
Yes. That's right. All well the people done, that Noah. Gave you pins, you could write
yeah,
to.
It, yeah, I texted everybody I knew. I was like, go like this post. But honestly, it wasn't. And even in the moment, I was like, this isn't a win for me. This is a win for like my grade and everyone who helped me, because it would not have been possible without them. Like, I had to borrow a dress. Someone took me to get my makeup and hair done. I got my nails done. I was like driven around.
I was a total celebrity.
Everybody like supported me. Like the dress changes and stuff. Like I had a whole team that was like lipstick and like changing earrings and like putting a dress on.
And Noah, I'm sorry you didn't have that experience. It looks like it was an awful lot of fun.
I am too.
So the highlight of your trip to Belgium was something very different, I'm sure.
Belgium is very interesting because there's buses and trains everywhere. So there's 300 exchange students in all of Belgium, and we pretty regularly got together with the train system.
Oh, so great.
So yeah, so the best thing I did was one of the Rotary clubs down in the south, and when I say south, I mean there was one of their exchange students living in France. They were the most south club in Belgium.
Okay.
They put together a soccer tournament for the exchange students by country. So the Americans made a soccer team versus teams like there was two Brazilian teams and an Ecuador team and a Chile team.
Oh, yeah.
So people who really do soccer professionally. Yes. Yeah. So, yeah. How so the Americans do?
The Americans didn't do very well.
But did you have fun and play well?
We had a great time.
The brotherhood.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But the best part was suddenly in the middle of this tournament, a team popped up. The Americans played against Puerto Rico. And at first, that didn't really ring any bells or anything because there's no Puerto Rican exchange students. All the best players from each country in South America that were friends got together to make like a 10-person team and called it Puerto Rico because there's no exchange students.
Fabulous.
But they actually didn't even end up winning because they got paired versus us. And we did so poorly, they got 0 points for winning. So it was just all in good fun, and we had a great time that day.
So all the exchange students are about the same age group, right?
Yes. In Belgium, it's a high school program for exchange. Uh-huh. A lot of exchange students in Belgium were over 18 after, because Belgium is one of the few countries that accepts people who have already graduated. So there are age restrictions for going to certain countries, but luckily with Belgium, we were able to all go there and practice French or Flemish for a lucky few.
Oh, wow.
Fabulous. Cool. So the two of you graduated from Bedford before you left.
Yeah, yes. We did.
So were you in school then for another year, or?
Yep.
Yeah, so we just kind of did another senior year, but like for me, it didn't really count for anything. And like when I got there, you know, my Spanish wasn't that great.
But and that's what you went to improve.
Yeah, and even more than that, like they take a lot of different subjects or they teach things really differently. And so like I wasn't even on half the class list. Like I would show up and like do the homework and take the test. I think I failed literally every chemistry test. To pass, you need like a 52, I think, and I got a 51 was my highest, and I was like.
But all the classes were in
Spanish. Yeah. And what really surprised me.
And the books are all in Spanish.
About Bolivia is like, you're so far from the U.S. border that a a lot of people don't speak English, or they don't speak English well, or they don't speak English well enough that I can understand them. And so, like, I really had to speak Spanish, because there were some people who spoke English, but not everyone did, which I just kind of thought, like,
everybody did too.
But, like, everyone will at least have basics, you know? But there's a lot of people who actually didn't.
Wow.
But it was good, because I had to learn Spanish to be able to communicate.
Did you find there was an English backup that you could deal with, or were you totally immersed as well?
Very basic English was kind of a standard throughout all the students there. And I've always heard in Europe, most of the adults are bi or trilingual. That's not entirely true. They mostly got that through work, actually. When they work with people from other countries, that's when they learn the new language. So all my friends in high school were going through these English classes with me, and the funniest part about the English classes was they all were learning British accents. All the teachers had learned British accents in these proper schools.
Yeah.
So it was all my friends, me with my American accent, and then all of my friends just with these really thick British accents learning with a combo of Belgian, French, and British English.
How did you, in class, now we've had, the exchange students that we've had said they could understand the teacher because the teacher was, being more careful in what they said with them in the classroom, but they had difficulty understanding the conversation from the other students in the class. Mm-hmm. Did you find that a problem, or?
I actually had the opposite.
Really?
With subjects I was familiar with, like physics, I had taken an applied science course.
Yep.
So I had physics, chemistry, and biology. And with the courses, like math and the sciences that I were familiar with, I was able to understand the teachers. But I had tougher times in history and things that I didn't know. And then because they do a lot of lecture in Belgium.
Yep.
So it was a lot of speaking quickly and taking notes. But all my friends had all the slang that I picked up really well, so.
Best slang from Belgium is?
Tagol. It literally means your snout, which is their version of basically telling someone to be quiet. They say your snout.
Your snout?
Yes.
Say that one more time.
Tagol.
Tagol. All right. Mm-hmm. I think there are places I might use that. And in Bolivia?
For slang or for what?
For slang.
Well, where I lived, so, every city in Bolivia is really different because they're so isolated geographically. They have their own way of speaking, their own slang, everything.
Oh, that's right.
So in my city, they had a really thick, like, Santa Cruz accent, and they were really proud of it. So they had so much slang. Actually, there's a lot of things that I will, like, say or do that I don't even realize it's slang. Like, I just think it's Spanish and everyone understands it. But I would say, like, the really famous one in Santa Cruz is they say, like, alaipue, which it doesn't even have a translation. It's like if someone does, you tell someone not to do something and then they do it and then it doesn't turn out good for them, you're like, alaipue. Pue is just
does
like.
Does that kind of go to tough beans?
Yeah. It's almost like I told you so, but like.
Ah, okay, but with a
that's like
will.
As close as it translates, but not in the same, like.
Now, going to Bolivia, that's south of the equator, right?
Yeah.
So you went from fall here into spring.
Spring. I've had, like, eternal summer. So, because, we had, like, the really mild fall. When I left, it was still really warm. I got there. It's so hot. We were, like, closer to the jungle than the mountains. So to me, it was like Massachusetts summer. Then we actually hit summer, and you just feel like you're dying.
Wow.
And then we had fall, which it was starting to cool off, but like not that much. And then I came back
and
it's summer.
And we got a hot spring.
I'm so ready for fall. Like, I just want cooler weather. I know everyone in Massachusetts, I guess it was like a bad spring, but like I just want it to cool off.
Well, and today, although it was hot over the weekend, precipitously hot in many places, it's pretty crisp out there right now.
Yeah, like this is what I want.
This
like a
nice
whole season of this. I don't care if it rains. I just don't want it to be 90 degrees.
There you go.
Noah, was the climate in Bolivia like somewhat like here?
In Belgium. Oh, it's not good. In Belgium, it's very gray. There was a lot of clouds. So unfortunately, some of the South Americans had the opposite problem of Kira. They went from their fall back into, they went from their spring into a fall. So they had a year and a half of winter. And the Belgian winters, it snowed once, with actual snow on the ground, but it was just always cloudy and cold, and it rained a fair amount.
Oh, wow. That doesn't.
So it wasn't great, but it was funny because there's two Norwegian girls who had come down, and they're like, this is a great winter. It's super bright out every day. The sun's going down at 4 p.m. This is great. Best winter they've ever had in their lives.
Everything is about perspective, right?
Exactly.
Where did you come from? What are you bringing in your head? So what are you guys going to do in the coming year? Are you headed to U.S. colleges or?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. So we applied to college before we left, and then we deferred. Yeah. So my college is in D.C. I just got back from orientation.
And fabulous.
Yeah.
I'm going to UMass Amherst in the fall for mechanical engineering. And I also did my new student orientation, and it's great. I'm so excited to go to college. And luckily, I've met another exchange student who went to Thailand, who is part of a Rotary, not just Rotary, but an exchange student club at UMass Amherst. So I'll be able to join that in the fall.
Oh, you can join the international group.
Yep.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That is cool.
Outstanding. And you'll be in school in D.C.
Yeah.
What are you going to be studying?
International relations.
Oh, well, you said that
yeah.
earlier on. Yes, Mother Turn, just pay attention, would you?
I should put this on my resume.
Yes.
You certainly could. You absolutely certainly could. So have we asked everything except what you guys might want to share with people that we haven't asked you to share? No pressure.
For sharing, I had a great time on exchange. I think every student should at least look at the possibility to going somewhere else. Mm-hmm. Learning a second language, it can be difficult in the beginning, but for me, I had 300 other friends also struggling with that. So I had a great network, I had a great year, and just overall, I got to learn new things, try new things, and meet new people, which was just amazing.
How long did it take to catch on to the language when you started feeling a little bit more comfortable?
It took me a solid 3 or 4 months, almost 5, because I had a very good grammar base from all my years of French, but my accent and understanding some of the slang they used in the beginning was very difficult. But after,
and you don't have a British accent.
I don't, yes. So in French, it took me a solid 5 months. But then I switched to my second family who didn't speak a word of English.
Really,
and then my French got really, really good.
How about you?
I think one thing that I would just add is, like, we talked about all these cool stories and all these experiences. And there was so many opportunities that we had in these big events. But honestly, what I miss most is just the day-to-day life. Like, it's like the little things is what I miss, you know, like taking the bus or going to school or things that you wouldn't even think about missing.
Yeah, they have yellow school buses down there?
No. And you do have like a lot of downtime, but it was really cool to have that and to just like have those little moments of just being in Bolivia.
With your new family.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
We didn't even ask you about your new families. We got all the way out here and didn't say anything about where you were staying and who those people were.
Yeah, so I only had two families, but my first family, they were really nice. I really loved them. Like, my host dad reminded me so much of like my real dad here in the U.S. They were always just joking around, and we really got along well. And they did live pretty far. They actually lived outside the city and like, I think we would probably call it a suburb, but that doesn't really exist in Bolivia, so it's just kind of called part of the city. We have to cross a river to get there. But I really liked living there. It was a lot of fun. I liked their dog. We were actually looking at photos of her on my mom's phone the other day. And then my second host family, they lived like right in the middle of the city, which was super cool because I was so close to everything.
Oh, yeah.
And I got to talk to them a lot about like Bolivian politics or like why things were just all the questions I had about Bolivia, I could ask them.
And their form of government is
it's so different. Yeah, or I'd be like, why do we do this? Or like, what is this? And my host mom was actually from Argentina, so I had to like learn a completely different accent because it is so different from the Bolivian accent. But that was cool to get to experience that too because I got to learn maybe a little more about Argentina.
Wow.
And just like her stories
this
and stuff.
So
and I got to meet her family, which was really cool. And I loved their extended family. Like my host cousin had been a Rotary Exchange student. Yeah. And
I just love the idea of a host cousin.
Isn't this something? I know. Yeah. I know. They really become part of the culture. Yeah.
There were some people who were really close with their extended host family. I was probably medium. I would get to see them. My first host family had lunch every Saturday with the grandparents and the uncle. And then my second host family, I would see them. It wasn't as scheduled, but maybe once every 2 months or so. But that was really cool to have that.
Noah, how about you?
I stayed with my first host family for 5 months, which was half of my exchange. So I really got to know them. I had a younger sister and my mom, obviously, but she worked a lot. So me and my sister would just play ping pong during the day after school and stuff like that. And it was really fun. And then I moved to my second host family. And my only host sibling was my pet dog, who looked like a little lion when he got his hair cut. His name was Tommy. And then my host parents didn't speak. My host mom was Spanish, and my host dad was Italian. So it was a really good mix of culture, yeah. And then my third host family felt most like home because I had two host siblings. I had a brother and a sister. And then I had my mom and my dad. And there was just always movement around the house. Somebody was always going somewhere or doing something. And it just felt like I fit in.
I'm really hoping that Bedford High School students will listen to what you guys have just said and consider this opportunity. Oh, yeah. It's a good, unbelievable learning. And when you hit college, your wheels will be spinning.
Yeah.
It's not like this going, what are we going to do in college? It's we know what we're going to do in college. That is so good. We're lucky to have guests this.
And we are extraordinarily fortunate. Extraordinarily fortunate.
And we're going to have a little follow-up with host parents.
All right, then. All right, then. So thank you both very much. Congratulations on accumulating all those pins and getting them attached to your jackets. I think that probably wasn't a simple operation.
Yeah, they fall off every time we walk.
Yes. Or when you send it to the cleaners and you have to figure out where everything goes again.
You don't clean it. But really, most importantly, welcome back to Bedford.
Thank you.
You've made us all very proud, absolutely.
And all the very best in your next adventure in Washington and out in Amherst.
Great.
We'll see
Thank you.
Thank you for being with us.
We'll be right back for one more little section.
Is that
okay?
I'm fine with that. Excited about it. Yay!
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Good going. Thank you very much.
Truly wonderful.
Hi, and welcome back to the second segment of Bedford Common Special Summer Edition.
Amen.
This has been a real special edition so far.
It has been And who's with us tonight?
We had the two youth exchange students.
Yeah.
And who were outbounders.
Yeah.
And to have an outbound student, you have to have inbound students.
So it balances.
Yep. So it balances. We had two inbound students from the Bedford Rotary Club.
All right.
And we are fortunate to have one of the host parents. I won't figure out how many parents we had. Maybe we can get that straightened out. So we have, and actually the inbound host parent was the parent of the two outbound students. And it's Becky Mance.
Wow.
Becky, welcome to Bedford Common.
Thank you.
How nice to see you here.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming to join us. And
thank you for having me.
So you have much experience in this Rotary Exchange thing.
I do.
How early did your experience start?
I was actually a Rotary Exchange student after I graduated high school. I spent a year in Mexico. And then a few years ago, we hosted a student from Brazil when we lived in Illinois. And then both of my kids, as you have met, decided to go on exchange this last year. And so when the two students were coming in, Rotary asked if we would be willing to host. And we said, of course, we would love to. So we've hosted Daya and David last year.
So
it worked out great. There were two empty beds right in your house.
That is true. They did sort of fill. We joked that they were our loner kids for the year.
Did they both stay with you at the same time?
They did. Yes. Okay. So that's unusual. Rotary, I've never heard of that before. I don't think that's customary. But because of the way it worked with all the scheduling and everyone's busy, trying to accommodate everyone,
it is difficult trying to schedule three parents and three hosts and two sets of kids.
And so it ends up being more than that a lot of times. So we had both boys with us from December until March. Yeah.
Outstanding. And your one word or two word description of the Rotary Exchange Program would be?
Oh goodness, that's hard.
Well, that's oh goodness.
One or two words.
Oh goodness is a couple of good
oh
words.
Oh goodness. I would say life changing. Those would be my two words. There's no way that you can go on exchange and come back the same person. It just changes your perspective. It changes what you understand about yourself, what you understand about the world, the way you think about things, I think. And so I think it's phenomenal in that respect.
So when your children came home, they weren't like children anymore.
No, exactly. And it's been wonderful to watch them grow. And it's just phenomenal. I was all year long, people kept telling me, it must be so hard with your kids gone. And of course it was. There's nothing easy about an exchange year, I will just say that. But there's also something phenomenal going on. And now having them home and hearing their stories around the dinner table and just hearing their experiences, and it's been amazing. And again, to hear how their thought processes have changed and how their perspectives have changed and things Kira mentioned earlier, just understanding the things you appreciate about your own culture that you took for granted before, and Noah would make us laugh during the year where there were things about our family that maybe he didn't appreciate before. So as a parent, that's kind of nice to hear that, you know, they're...
Amen. Yeah. I'm not going to say way back when, but when you decided to apply to be a Rotary Exchange student on your own, what led you to that decision?
Oh, it was just craziness. So my best friend and I in high school, I grew up in Colorado. We had decided, our Spanish teacher came into class one day and just said, hey, there's this exchange program, and if you're interested, you should fill out the application. It's due today. So over lunch, my friend and I talked about it, and we're like, wouldn't that be so cool? We'll go to England, and we'll have this year. And so we had
and
it all worked out. Exactly.
Learn a lot of Spanish in England, yes.
And in our high school, understanding how we control the world, we were both going to go to England on exchange. Well, it didn't work out that way. I was selected to go to Mexico, and I was really pretty upset about it originally. And then my dad talked to me and said, you're crazy to not understand what an opportunity this is. And I realized he was right. And so I went to Mexico. And that is a big part of Rotary. They do not like to send students to countries where they speak the same language, because that's a big part of culture, actually, is learning another language, learning, because there's so much involved in your language we don't think about. It represents the way we speak, the things that are important to us, the way we communicate. And so there was no way they would have sent me to England. And I can appreciate that now. But at the time, I didn't appreciate it. Because I panicked and I thought, oh my gosh, what am I going to do in Mexico? They don't speak English.
I've only taken 4 years of Spanish. It's not enough.
I had taken five, but it didn't seem like enough. But I will say this, coming home, I did come home fluent. When I went to university on my return, I did end up graduating with a degree in Spanish without even trying, because I entered at such a high level by the time it was time for me to graduate, they looked at my credits and said, oh, well, you're actually, majoring in this, but you can have a Spanish major if you'd like. And I said, okay, thank you. I'll take that.
Wow.
Have you ever used it?
I still use it. In fact, having Kira come home has been wonderful, because she and I can speak. But,
I sense a cabal going there, that the two of you can say things that no one else knows.
Well, Noah, though, it's a Romance language, and so the Latin verbs, so there's enough of a Latin root that he can follow along. He's a smart kid.
Okay.
No, and we don't want to be exclusionary, so we
there
don't.
You go.
I never asked your kids about the, you have the courage, yes, I want to do it, but then you actually get a step on the airplane.
Yes.
When you went through security and then you were on your own, that must have been a pretty scary feeling at that point.
It was terrifying. I cried. Yeah. I mean, I had not flown a lot. I mean, this is just a different world than what everyone's living in today. But I remember getting on the plane and sitting in my seat and just crying and thinking, what in the heck have I just committed to? But again, you're greeted by your family. And I think David and Guy had talked about that. Yeah, you do. Back in the day, we wrote hand letters, but they had sent a photograph and they'd handwritten a letter and I had written letters to them. So you have someone, greeting you, and you know a little bit about them. But you're right, it does, it takes courage. I mean, like I say, exchange is a phenomenal year. If you want an easy year, do not go on exchange. If you want a life-changing year, go on exchange.
But as a host parent, now Now you did not, did you greet the inbound students?
We were not the first host family, so okay. We did not. We right. were the second host family, so yeah.
But they went to the airport and met them. They really mm-hmm. had never seen each other face to face until they got off the plane, standing there, hope the picture matches.
Excuse me, who are you? What did you say?
Well, I think it is different now because you can FaceTime, you can Skype, can, you know, WhatsApp. There's so many ways that you can. And I think, I know we had sent emails to both David and Daya because we knew that we would be hosting, even though we didn't know necessarily where we'd be in the lineup. We had sent them, and especially with the kids being seniors at high school, said, hey, you know, ask us any questions you have, let us, you know, because you know that they're all wondering, it's that great unknown. So the communication lines are definitely open, and that I think takes a little bit of the edge off for the kids.
Well, and certainly, as you say, FaceTime and all the computer phone magic that happens now.
Exactly.
So did you keep track of Noah and Kira while they were abroad?
We did. We in the beginning, we talked before they left about what would be an appropriate amount of time. We wanted them to have the full experience. So we had agreed not to visit, not to go. We would love to go, and we've agreed that maybe in the future we'll go back with them, but we didn't want to interrupt that dynamic with their families.
I think Rotor kind of discourages that.
They do discourage that, and they really discourage, because of the homesickness in the beginning, it's good to just sort of let them go and work through that. But we sort of fell into a rhythm after the first couple months that we asked them for a sign of life once a week, just even if it was a quick text, you know,
like
it's all good. I'm alive.
I ate lunch the other day.
But, but honestly, we really didn't worry about them. Yeah. I mean, we didn't.
Which must have been pretty scary to do too.
Yeah, well, I mean, they would send pictures. We would ask for pictures every now and then just to know, you know, even without any text with it, just to see that what they were up to and what they were seeing. And so. But that's part of being a parent, isn't it? Is sort of letting go and saying.
It is, and it's part of the exchange. If you are looking for an easy year, you don't do it at all. And if you're looking for some challenge, and if you're looking for growth as a parent.
That's true.
One of the things that you did real well was you got David and Daya lined up with school projects. Like they were in the high school play, and they played basketball and ran on track team.
Well, I don't take any credit for that. They're first host family, so the Santerres and the Bridgemans had the boys first. And that, if you're the first host family, you really are very busy because you are getting the kids, you know, signed up in school and introducing them to all the different activities and getting them immersed and encouraging all those friendships.
Helping to set up their schedule, too.
Exactly, and setting up the schedule. And so by the time the boys came to us, Daya had already auditioned for the play. So it was funny, he had auditioned, but practice started after he came to our house. So then we were with him through that period.
Through all the rehearsals, helping
through all the rehearsals,
lines.
Exactly.
Did he practice the dancing? At your house?
He did, mostly more in the basement, kind of on his own, that he did. But yeah, there's a lot of, I mean, it's back to parenting, so there were nights that we would do homework.
We get to fill in that part, because I don't think the rest of the audience really knows.
They're wondering what.
Oh, yes, that's true.
That's right. Daya was in Fiddler on the Roof.
Yes.
And there's a real tough dancing where they dance with a bottle on their head. Yeah, tell us a little about that.
He was a feature dancer, and he was so proud of that. But I think what people have to understand is, again, sort of like Kira and having her beauty pageant, Daya had never been in a play before. He had never been in a musical. He didn't even really know what a musical was, because it's a very American theater art. And so when he came, this was so far out of his comfort zone when he auditioned. And so then to get a dancing part in a musical and singing.
Where he had to keep a bottle.
Had to keep a bottle. And the bottles were not taped on in any way. They were just balanced on their heads. And yet he rose to the occasion. He learned all of his lines. He learned the dance steps. He did it all phenomenally well. And so to watch him, and again, as a parent, it was really exciting to watch him in his personal growth going through that. Because again, it was a huge challenge. It was so out of his comfort zone, but he was so well supported and he was having a great time and he did it and he did it well. And so then he, you know, and he didn't have to worry. We would always tell the kids, David and Daya, you know, you're here, do whatever you want because no one's judging you. I mean, at home you may feel like you don't have the freedom Because these are people you go to school with. These are people who have known you your whole life. These are people you will continue to go to school with. But here you don't have to worry so much about that. And like David, if people remember, he had quite the haircut. Well, because he could. Because at home, you can't do crazy things with your hair. But when he got here, he's more free. So he had sort of this modified mohawk that he kept. And why not? I mean, that's the fun of it. It's just hair.
His parents probably died.
Well, and so before he went home, though, I'm sure he got his hair cut and put it back into standard. And Carlos, who was the exchange student a couple years ago, we knew him as well. And he did the same thing because in Taiwan, you have to have a very standard haircut to go to school. You cannot be outside the parameters. And so he did all kinds of crazy things with his hair. So it's a fun time in your life to do that.
And David he was into the sports. He got to play basketball with the police department.
Exactly. He did the rec league, and that was when he was with us, and we went to all of his games and got to cheer him on, and so that was fun. And that's why I call them my loner kids, as we were right back into full-fledged parenting. Picking kids up from high school, taking them to practices, making sure they were where
all
they
the
needed
right
to
stuff.
Be when they needed
all
to
the
be
right
there.
Stuff.
Yeah,
all
actually,
the right
I
stuff.
Think Rhode, we have an outbound student going to Japan this year from Rotary.
Yes.
And so, therefore, because we have an outbound, we have to have an inbound student.
Right.
And I believe we have an inbound student from, is it Argentina?
I
don't know.
I don't know for sure.
Well, I have to find that
maybe
out.
Maybe Brazil or Argentina.
Maybe it is Brazil. Oh.
Is this a good time to ask if there are any parents in the audience who haven't signed up as host families yet who might be interested?
This would be a wonderful time to consider, contacting myself,
Bedford
TV.
There you go. Or Rotary in Bedford.
Rotary Club of Bedford. And I think we are looking for some hosts. I know we have one. We couldn't start unless we had one beginning host. But we might be looking for a second host or a third host.
And I have also heard that it's okay to have more hosts than you need. Because if you're not going to host this year, next year is coming up.
That is true.
And so it's kind of a good way to get slotted in and be used to the process and sign up.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Actually, my wife Jean and I hosted on just a quick ask. Somebody calls us, Ralph, will you do me a favor? And I go, oh, yeah, sure. You need to host a kid. And I said, oh, yeah, we'll do that. Better ask Jean first. And she said, sure. And we did it, and we had no idea what we were going to get into.
Right.
And but there was a whole training process and sharing process among Rotarians, and boy, it was the best year of our life. It was just wonderful. And not only that, when Sylvie came, I got her registered at Bedford High and all that stuff. When she got married, we got invited to her wedding back in Germany. And the even more cool part is when we went to the reception, we thought we'd be sitting over in the corner because we're the only ones that didn't speak German. My wife is pretty good at it, but I was awful at it. They said, oh, no, Ralph and Jean, you don't sit there. You sit up here with us. We sat at the head table because we were family.
There you go.
Isn't that something?
Awesome.
What an honor you get when you become a host.
That's true. Well, they really do fold in and become part of your family.
Yeah.
And so that is, it really is a very special dynamic. Yeah.
And it's something that will always be part of our lives forever.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Becky, we really appreciate you coming on and sharing with us.
Thank you for having
me. Blessed be. I think I need to go back and start my life over and get in this path.
And well, having the courage yourself to go off an exchange student, but the courage to let your children go off. I mean, that does take a lot of courage, but the parents that have done that would say, I do it again in the heartbeat.
That's true. Yep. Rotary is well supported.
Yep. And it's not like you don't know where they're going. We know the other club they're going to, the other people, and it's all part of the whole system that works in.
So if when all of this is July, so midsummer, and so probably not in September, but in the fall, we will meet the new students and the new host families. And so this is going to be an ongoing story.
Right. So thank you very much for watching this special student exchange segment of Bedford TV.
Exactly. The summer special.
In Bedford Common. And we have a special program this time. We have our students who are taking the summer classes or mentors at the summer classes. We have Isaac, who's in grade 12, and he's an intern. We have Healy, who is in grade 8. She's a mentor. Matthew, in grade 6, is assisting with this. Catherine is part of the staff here at Bedford TV and director. Katie Duvall is assisting. I don't know, she's out there on something or other. But they're doing a great job running this. Healy, good job running the camera.
The whole thing. It takes a village.
Right. And thank you all very much. And Nora and Kara are still there. Thank you very much for watching this other segment with your mother.
But the silly part is we say good night, Bedford.
Good night, Bedford. Thank you so much.
Good night.
Bye-bye.